Hey, what's up, gamers and all the ships at sea? My name is AE, and I like to play E. This is my YouTube channel, Let's Play E, where I'm going to share some of my favorite games and other forms of play with anyone who cares to watch and listen. Today, I'm playing Vampire Survivors. You can check out this retro pixel roguelite survival reverse bullet hell beauty of a game on Steam, now at the low special limited time sale price of just $9.99. No, I'm kidding you. We have fun here. It's actually $2.99, and that's the full regular price, which in my case already works out to be less than a penny per hour of fun. The game is currently in early access, but is entirely playable, and there are regular content updates, both in line with a published developer's roadmap for version 1.0.0, and containing a steady feed of secrets and surprises to uncover. No DLC, no NFTs, no pay to play or pay to win, no loot boxes, just boxes to loot. I have just been joined by my very nice office cat, Tommy. I'm going to give her a little treat because she politely tapped me on the shoulder to let me know she's here, and I like to reward that behavior. Eventually, I hope to improve my recording setup to have a face cam so that she will be able to participate at these junctures. Because otherwise, you're going to be hearing about her every time I do this without seeing her. And I've been on the internet enough to know that's not acceptable. This is my second attempt at starting this channel. The first was beset by technical difficulties with my computer's hard drive. I'm not going to dwell on that because this is not a channel for difficulties. We've all got enough of those with... But if you're thinking you've already seen the first episode of me playing Vampire Survivors, you're not wrong. I do like to think the second attempt might be a little better for the experience I already have. But I do want to share Vampire Survivors with as many people as possible because it's a remarkable game, yet an almost biblically indescribable one. It's hard to understand the appeal of it without seeing it, and I don't think I would have thought to check it out myself in a million years if I hadn't chanced to see Jacob Andrews of Drawfee play it on his shared gaming stream with his now fiance, Julia Le Petit, on Secret Sleepover Society here on YouTube. My home network situation does not support streaming from my office, so I'm making Let's Plays. This is a deceptively simple game with surprisingly deep gameplay, so I actually have three different sets of videos I'm working on to showcase three different play experiences. This one is a basic Let's Play that will show a playthrough from start to finish, the current finish of the game anyway, so you can see what the game is like when you first get it, and follow the experience of unlocking more of its secrets for as long as you desire, as long as I keep making them. The gameplay evolves as you progress, so if the first episode looks promising but not really engrossing, I hope you'll stick around to see how it picks up just even a few runs into it. That's about enough preamble. Let's get into it. Gonna pause to turn on Tommy's seat warmer for her. Now she has politely asked me to do that. Okay, so we start with a photosensitivity warning. I'll leave that up there for you to read. If you have a photosensitive condition, I trust that you know your condition and your limits and needs. Please bear in mind, you do not owe it to anybody to consume any content they put on the internet for any reason. Your comfort, health, safety, and peace of mind do come first. In a moment, I will go into the options and turn off the flashiest of the flashy visual effects. But I'd like to take a moment to just marvel at the splash screen, which I love so much. It's really a great example of the game's aesthetic, the visual appeal of the retro game. This is not what the actual gameplay looks like. But it's spot on for what you would have as the box art or the cartridge art and the illustrations in the manual or the side of an arcade cabinet in the late 80s, early 90s. This game is strongly influenced, at least aesthetically and thematically, by the 8 and 16-bit iterations of the Castlevania franchise. Gameplay, absolutely unrelated, but the shoestring of a storyline, the characters, the conceits, all very Castlevania. So I'm going to uncheck the flashing VFX. I'm going to turn on visual joystick. I don't use it very much, but I like to be able to see it. and we'll leave everything else here as it is. I have turned the sound and music down quite a bit, as it can be very much like the sound of being on a busy casino floor, especially as the game progresses and more things are happening at once. And I do plan on speaking quite a bit, so I may adjust the volume balance after I get some feedback on these videos, if people watch them and leave feedback. On the subject of sound, I should mention, I do have, it is August, and it is very hot and humid. I have AC running in the next room, and I have a small cooling device on my neck. Both of those do make some noise that the microphone picks up. I have a noise filter on. If my voice sounds a little distorted, robotic, underwater, like I'm talking through a fan, my sound tests, it did not seem too overwhelmingly bad. And just as a compromise, I really cannot do this without some form of artificial cooling. So for now, my voice may be weird. As the months move into fall and winter, that may disappear for a bit. Any event, so this is a game. It's a game of progression, like the similarly roguelite game Hades that was a breakout hit a few years back. And is still fairly popular to this day, as far as I know. It's a game of macro game progression. You play the game expecting to die early and die often, but each time you play, you're not only getting better as a player at the skills and strategy of playing the game, you are unlocking things and you are amassing resources that allow you to upgrade and carry over progress. Each run is a self-contained playthrough, bounded in time and space, but there are some things that carry over, and especially early on, you will be making progress fairly often. That each run, you will be more powerful. Not really going to look at the screen for this, but I'll show you there's an unlock tree. I have nothing unlocked. Collection. I have 3 of 93. That is the one and only starting weapon, the whip, very familiar to Castlevania fans. And the two basic pickups, an experience gem and a gold coin. The coins are up here. I mentioned there's no pay to win. You cannot convert real money for in-game currency. You've got to play to amass those coins. You can use the coins to buy power-ups. These are things that apply to every run and every character. There's only so many of them, and they all cost coins. But this is the first way you have of advancing your character, the equivalent of grinding for experience, the only one that's obvious at the start. And we will start. There are four characters revealed at the start. Only one is actually unlocked, Antonio. Definitely not Simon Belmont, just a vampire hunter from a long line of vampire hunters armed with a magic vampire-killing whip. There are three other characters who are discovered, known at the start of the game. They also cost coins to unlock, and other characters can be discovered through play. The term unlock is used somewhat inconsistently in the game, in that the achievements that reveal a character are also described as unlocking, but most or all of them arrive as silhouettes who cannot be selected until you have paid the toll. So, with no other choices, I'm going to jump in as Antonio. And here we go. The only controls this game has during actual gameplay are movement. I'm using the WASD keys on the keyboard to move with four directions or combining them for diagonal. You can also use the mouse for more degrees of freedom. I find it somewhat counterintuitively more fluid to use the keyboard because you can turn much quicker. I'm fighting these bats. I said the only controls were movement, and you might be wondering how I'm firing. If you've noticed that the whip is attacking at a constant rate, that is because the game automatically does that. Every weapon fires at its cooldown rate. When you get enough experience to fill this blue bar, you get a level up. You get a choice of three or four items, some of which may be things you already have, and the more new things I pick, the more likely they are to be repeats. There's only six slots if you count the boxes there. I could diversify my attacks. I'm going to take the second level of whip immediately. Because that second projectile it mentioned, now I can be walking away from the bats and still fighting them or going between them. The game changer. The gameplay of this game evolves both within each run and across them. Right now, there are more than six weapons, so I can't get all of them in a run, even if I fill all six slots. I'll take the Bible, thank you. Speaking of evolution, we just passed the 1 minute mark, and our bats have been joined by some ghoulies. They're a little tougher. The Bible, where the whip just fires horizontally, the Bible appears periodically orbiting me, a sort of shield. Not a terribly effective one at level one, especially when I don't have any power-ups on this character, and no passive accessories buffing it. It can evolve into a mighty weapon, though. So that bat with the blue aura around it down there, that is an elite bat. If I can kill it, it will drop a treasure chest. I'm not really able to stand still and trade blows with it without getting overwhelmed. And that's going to be a theme on this first run, is me just trying to avoid getting overwhelmed by the ever-growing horde of enemies. Every minute or so, gameplay changes. We will take the magic wand, which it fires at the nearest enemy. Little tiny blue star projectile. That's an example of how the gameplay changes through progressions. Those big clouds of bats, those big swarms, eventually they're going to be my best friend in the early game because I will be able to cut through them like a knife through hot butter and get a ton of experience all at once. But right now, all I can do is get out of their way. If I'm lucky, I might be able to pick some of them off with a whip slash as they go past and get some experience. If I'm not lucky, they'll push a huge crowd of monsters into me and kill me immediately. Speaking about getting killed immediately, I'm going to take the laurel. The laurel counts as a weapon, but it does not do any damage. That shadow energy shield surrounding me. If I take a hit, I will take no damage from it. The shield will disappear, and I'll flash. My sprite will flash a solid like that. Well, that sprite flash is happening. I'm invincible for a brief mercy window. And then the shield recharges. Not very impressive, especially with only one level of it, but it does greatly increase my chance of making it further in this run and unlocking more things. These skeletons, can't really do anything about the skeletons, so I'm gonna spend some time trying to weave away from them and go for these torches. Torches drop things like money, usually. That was a coin, it sounded like. Coins, I think, are the most common drop. They can also drop chicken, which is healing. And they can drop some fairly powerful pickup power-ups that I would hope to get. Okay, I just upgraded my Bible, and now I have two shields. My power has doubled. Not really, though, because that's a small fraction of my power at the moment. Still, it increases the odds that something coming near me is going to get whacked in the face with a flying Bible. We got some ghosts. The ghosts are not very powerful at all. If there's a crowd of enemies I have to move through, I'll go for the ghosts. Will we take the Santa water, the whip? We'll go armor, try to increase my survival. Armor appeared in the second row instead of the first. That is a passive accessory. Most game materials refer to them as passives. I think of them as accessories because that's the weapons are weapons, the accessories are accessories. It describes what type of equipment they are. And in a sense, most weapons in this game are entirely passive. In terms of the player's control. But the armor increases my survivability by decreasing the damage I take when something gets past my laurel shield. Oh, 5 minutes in, we have a mantis mini boss creeping at me, and this wall of flowers. The flowers are monsters using the standard monster AI, just moving very slowly. They are actually kind of tightening the circle around me. but they also have the same physics that lets monsters push each other into me, which means they create gaps as they push through. I cannot do anything about that mantis, even less than I can do about those elite bats. So I'm just gonna kind of circle, looking for torches and picking up as many experience gems as I can get. Skirting the growing horde of enemies so that my backwards whip slashes will hit them. The initial run gameplay. Yes, I think I will take the knife. The knife's behavior is very useful once you start upgrading it, in that it flies wherever you're aimed. If you're using the mouse to move, you have more degrees of freedom. Oh, here we go. Got myself a fire breath item, and got some chests from those elite bats, and the boss monster. Spinach is tempting. I'm going to take the axe so I can show you another Castlevania influence. The knife and whip are very Castlevania-based. The knife is the first alternative auxiliary weapon you get in most Castlevania games, and in those games, I'm talking about two-dimensional side-scrolling platform Castlevania for the NES, or Super NES in particular, but they're rapidly moving horizontal weapons that fly straight. And when you get the axe, it's stronger, but gets thrown in a parabolic arc. It's thrown up, and then travels across and goes down. Translating that from a side-scrolling to a top-down game is kind of interesting. Oh, and there I was able to take care of that swarm of bats. Let me get these. You see the axe gets tossed up. If it had not hit an enemy and expired, it would have fallen down towards the bottom of the screen. That is how they translate the parabolic arc of the axe to a top-down game. But I have three treasure chests open, so let's get to this. Oh my goodness! First treasure chest of a run, and it's a triple chest. This is the happiest I have been in weeks. I have described the chests in this game as being the most reliable source of dopamine for me available at the moment. They always give you weapons you already have. You're getting a free level of the weapon. My experience level does not change. I'm still level 9 as I was before I opened it, but three of my weapons are now more powerful. Extra projectiles, might be extra damage. Okay, I'm gonna tank some hits here to get to these chests. Because if I move away from them, then there's going to be a giant swarm of these green ghouls and other tough monsters. Okay, armor, that's good. The money is also good. It's a good solid source of money in the early game. It's not a lot by late game standards, but I'd have to pick up 63 individual coins to get that much money. Bible's up to level 3. Okay, I'm going to try to get away from this horde and focus on breaking some more torches. I'm used to playing this game with power-ups that increase your statistics, including the range at which you attract items that you pass by. That's why sometimes I walk past a coin and it seems like I could have moved just a few pixels to my side to get it, and I don't. It's because I expect it to come to me anyway, and it doesn't. We'll continue focusing on survival. One of the invisible statistics the axe has is pierce, which is the number of enemies it will go through before it expires. So if I manage... Oh, that's a problem. The bat's pushing monsters towards me. If I manage to level up the axe a bunch, you'll see it cleaving through multiple enemies and possibly falling all the way off the screen even as it's hitting things. It's already... Seems like it's going through at least one enemy. Might seem like a waste to pick up that chicken when I only had a sliver of health missing. But it's not like I could count on getting my way back to it when I need it. And there are things you unlock from getting pickups from torches that I hope to have unlocked for my second run. The better I do with this first run, the better my second run will be. I'm not going to mention particular times or benchmarks or goals. I have very little idea of what the difficulty of the game is like when you have nothing unlocked, or how far I should expect to get. Having armor And the laurel, I think, is going to help. I think it's helped all ra a lot already. Not only lets me take more hits, it lets me take more risks. For instance, I don't think I could have gotten all three of the treasure chests that fire breath power-up gave me if I did not have the laurel and armor, and did not know that I could get back out from inside the cluster of enemies that was converging on the second and third chest. The second accessory I'm taking is spinach. My impression is that until you start unlocking things, spinach, which buffs all of your damage, and armor, which buffs your resistance to damage, I think those are the only two accessories that are actually available to me on this run. If I'm good and lucky, I will have more accessories available for the second run. Oh, that's a nice thing to get. I probably should have made up my mind quicker about what I'm using that for. Yeah. Really interested in farming the torches. They don't spawn in particular places. I think there are some geography within the level as to where they can spawn. But basically, the game makes a periodic check on an invisible luck statistic. It's currently invisible. And if it's successful, it will spawn a torch just off screen of me. So if I kind of move around in a vaguely circular pattern, I should encounter more torches as well as experience gems I was not able to collect before. These red wing bats, very tough. Oh, 10 minutes in, we have the big boss version of that mantis mini boss. Not gonna stand and fight it. If I get another flame breath, I will turn around and try to obliterate it before the flame breath expires, but otherwise, I'm not likely to beat it. The 10-minute boss is an important benchmark later in the progression. Right now, it's just something to run away from. Level 4 of King Bible. I believe that unlocks something that I want. I don't remember what. Nothing pops up while you're playing to tell you that you've unlocked something. You get a series of notifications at the end of the run on your final game statistics. Oh. Hello, hello. Come on. There we go. Three more chests. And there's a flame breath there that I did not even need to use for the boss. Five. Five. This is blessed. It looks like it's a triple chest. But there were some subtle cues, like fireworks and giant musical stings at the beginning, that told me this was going to be a quintuple chest. Amazing. More whip. More King Bible. More laurel. I didn't have any more level. This is my second level of laurel. Okay. I should probably have pumped some levels into laurel before now. I haven't really been paying attention if it was coming up in the level up screen or not. I'm gonna leave that fire breath here for now. And hopefully, if I get into. Well, actually, no. It's 10:56. Yeah, in about 3 seconds. Less 4 seconds. Less than 4 seconds. More than 3 seconds. That fire breath is gonna become very relevant to me. Because at 11, when we hit 11 minutes. Which we just hit. That fire breath may translate to a few extra levels of experience for me. If I can time things right and don't get overconfident. Here we go, here we go. Right, I don't have a very long pickup range. Fire breath, time skeletons. Usually, on my current save, when I'm fully leveled, fully power leveled, everything's maxed out. The 11-minute skeleton spawn, because it happens at 11 minutes, it doesn't last 11 minutes, is a huge, huge deal for getting experience quickly, because you can see there's a ton of skeletons everywhere. But I'm still at the point where if I stayed in the middle of those skeletons, I would be overwhelmed and killed, especially since you can see there's still those green ghouls I have not been able to deal with in the middle of them. So I use the fire breath to try to pick my way through. Got some experience, less than I was hoping for. Well, I might actually max out one of my weapons. Wouldn't have picked the King Bible to be the thing I maxed out, but I did pursue getting it up to level 4, because that is a threshold for unlocking something. Oh, 12 minutes, we got werewolves. Okay, this is further than I could have counted on making it. But the appearance of werewolves signals that things are getting tougher. A 30-minute run, which that's how long these waves last. There are waves scheduled all the way up to minute 29 is the final wave. And then minute 30, you have effectively won the game. But it divides roughly into 3 acts. I think of them as early game, middle game, and late game. Minutes 1 to 10. Rather, minutes 0 through 9. 10 through 19. And 20 through 29. And there is a very real plateau effect in that the difficulty spikes. Ooh, red gem. The difficulty spikes during these 10-minute intervals. And later in my progression, I will also have ways of making my power spike. I think we need the extra penetration power on the axe more than anything else at this point. Trying to head north, because my axe is throwing at whatever's right ahead of me. And my whip will help keep things off of me from the sides. But basically, I'm just trying to keep one step ahead of the horde here. Sometimes I visualize what I'm seeing on screen, or I conceptualize, I should say, as a maze. And in this case, ghosts are doors that I can kick down, and werewolves are walls. Open space is best, but I'll go through a door if I have to. Not getting a lot of experience because of the fact that I'm moving, and I'm seeing coins from destroyed torches and occasionally getting a torch glimpsed off screen. Okay, minute 14, we got a mix of werewolves and red wing bats. This is where things are going to get really tricky, because I do not have effective tools for dealing with either of these things. So I'm just kind of moving. The fact that I can't stand still means there's not much time for torches to form, so I'm not seeing many in my direct path. I'm probably not going to be able to... Oh. Okay. I'm going to risk it for the biscuit. And I did not get it, but I got a triple chest on my first chest that I opened. I got a quintuple chest on my first run of the progression of the playthrough. I have over 500 coins. I have over 800 coins, but 500 is the benchmark I super care about here. And let's see what I've unlocked. Let's find out. I know some things. I suspect some things. I don't know everything that's going to pop up here. So I'm excited for this. Let's find out. I destroyed enough torches to get the fire wand. That's a weapon. Picked up enough 4 chickens to get the garlic. That's another weapon. Picked up a rosary. Got the cross. That's another weapon. Another weapon. King Bible unlocks bracer, that's important. Empty tome, that's huge. The crown, important, not so much for now, but for later. Wings, they can be situationally important. Hollow heart, important. I'm not really going to do much with that. That is a weapon. So I unlocked 10 things. I have so much gold for the early progression. Very happy with myself. I'm going to spend that gold at the start of the next video rather than doing it now, because what I spend it on will change up what the game is and how it plays in small ways at first, but great as I go on. And I don't want to have to try to remember or look up what I changed before I start my next adventure. So that was my first run of a new playthrough of Vampire Survivors. If you got anything out of watching this, please feel inordinately free to interact with the video in any of the prescribed fashions. Hit that like, ring that bell, sing Oh My True Love Are You Well, subscribe, support me on Patreon or Ko-fi in the links below. I have a link to the Steam page for Vampire Survivors also. $2.99 is an incredible bargain. If that price point and Steam's return policy aren't enough to tempt you to give it a try, you can also try a less complete build in your browser on the creator's itch.io page. While it lacks many unlockable features, the early progression of gameplay is very similar to what you've seen here today. That link is also down below, along with a link to the Secret Society vid, Secret Sleepover Society vid, that got me started. So, this is where I'm signing off. I'd like to just close by reminding you to do what you can to take care of yourself and each other, because in the end, we're all just trying to survive the night. This is AE, and I like to play. Thank you for watching.